Hello everyone, welcome to this session on molecular diagnosis of tuberculosis. I am Dr. Uma Devi, scientist in the National Institute for Research in Tuberculosis, Chennai. First of all, let us understand why do we need a molecular diagnosis for tuberculosis. As we all know, early and accurate diagnosis of tuberculosis is essential for an effective management of the patients, and there are many methodologies that are available for diagnosis of tuberculosis. In the earlier sessions, you must have heard about the conventional methods of diagnosis, including smear microscopy as well as culture and drug susceptibility testing by phenotypic methods. And as we all know, smear microscopy has its own sensitivity because we require about 10,000 bacilli per ml of the sputum for detecting positivity, and culture is a time taking process. So, the advantage of using a molecular diagnosis is that it has a rapid speed of detection for turnaround of the results. So, if you look at molecular diagnosis, it has an increased sensitivity to detect smear negative cases, and it can detect also the drug resistance in addition to the diagnosis, as well as the results have a quick turnaround time varying between 2 hours to 48 hours depending on the different methodologies. Therefore, this method can help in the diagnosis of patients at an earlier stage for treatment initiation and to cut down transmission. So, the next slide I am going to show about the different molecular tests that are currently available for doing diagnosis of tuberculosis and drug susceptibility testing. One is the commercial tools that are currently in place, which includes the CBNAAT, and one of the methods is by GeneXpert, and the other is line probe assay. Following that, I will also be discussing about the diagnostics that are in pipeline, which includes the Xpert Ultra, the Omni and the TrueNuts devices. And there are also a few in-house polymerase chain reactions, which I will be touching on during my presentation. I will also be touching on few of the sequencing technologies like the targeted sequencing and the whole genome sequencing, which is currently not utilized for patient management in India, but which can be utilized for discordant results or when there is further confirmation required. Coming to CBNAAT, or the cartridge based nucleic acid amplification test, currently we have the Xpert MTB RIF, which was one of the advanced technologies that had made a trend setting in the diagnosis of tuberculosis and rifampicin resistance reduction. So, this technology is based on a semi-nested real time PCR and molecular beacon technology to detect MTB as well as rifampicin resistance. So, this test has been approved by the US FDA as a diagnostic test for TB since 2013. So, it has been rolled out in India by the Central TB Division for TB diagnosis since 2014. The Xpert MTB RIF assay has reduced the turnaround time for detection with a reporting time of 2 hours compared to the conventional methodologies which requires more than a few weeks for detection and drug resistance reporting. In addition to detecting M tuberculosis, it also detects rifampicin resistant mutations, and this can be utilized for detection of TB and RIF resistance in biological specimens like sputum, fluids and tissues. There had been a considerable amount of evidence that has been produced for rifampicin reduction and diagnosis of using Xpert in urine as well as stool samples. However, blood could not be an ideal specimen for diagnosis using GeneXpert. Currently, the program recommends the detection of sputum, fluids and tissues using GeneXpert. This cartoon shows the actual procedure that is followed for GeneXpert detection. On the left side, you can see the GeneXpert machine. This is a 4 module cartridge that is used here. There are different machines which uses either a 1 module system, 4 module or a 16 module system. And the bottom on the left, you can see the cartridge that is being put into these modules and the lysis buffer that is provided along with this cartridge. So, as such, the hands-on required during this procedure is only for a 2 minutes duration, during which the sample is added to the container which is given, and then the buffer is added to this sample in the container in the ratio of 2:1 ratio and then left for incubation for 15 minutes at room temperature. Later, 2 ml of this material is transferred into a test cartridge. With this, the hands-on work on this assay is completed. This cartridge is then placed into the module of the Xpert machine, and where the sample is actually filtered, washed, and the DNA is released, and the DNA is also mixed with the PCR reagents, and then following this, there is a seminested real-time amplification which occurs within this machine, and the results are seen through a desktop or a laptop screen, and which is a printable results that is obtained. This slide shows the patient ID and the sample number, and also gives the test results as to whether the biological sample is MTB detected or not detected, and also resistance reduction for rifampicin or absence of resistance for rifampicin. At the bottom, it also gives the results for each of the 5 probes that are used in this assay, and also it has a sputum processing control. So, let us look at the key population that are tested by MTBRIF as given by the guidelines of RNTCP. So, in patients who are suspected of MDR tuberculosis, which includes retreatment cases, failure cases, or contacts of MDR TB, could be tested for GeneXpert, and also children who are suspected for tuberculosis and people who are living with HIV and having symptoms suggestive of tuberculosis could be tested by GeneXpert. And also GeneXpert is useful for detection of tuberculosis in extrapulmonary patients. In the case of extrapulmonary samples like biopsies, it requires additional processing compared to regular biological specimen like sputum, but the assay time on the machine is the same as biological specimens. When the GeneXpert was initially rolled out in the country, it was in a phased manner, and a multi-site phased implementation study was carried out in India, where they had shown that there was a 33% increase in presumptive TB case detection after the rolling out of GeneXpert. Such was the power of this technology. And also, there was a study which looked into the pediatric TB population for the diagnosis of tuberculosis and drug resistance reduction in the sputum as well as in the extrapulmonary specimens, where again TB detection rate was found 2-fold higher with Xpert MTBRIF as compared to smear microscopy. So, if you look at the advantages and disadvantages of using CBNAAT, the advantage is that it has a rapid turnaround time and it has the ability to detect very low number of organisms, and the detection of MTB along with drug susceptibility testing could be directly done from the sputum samples. And it is a completely automated process except for the 2 minutes hands-on that is required in the initial stages, and it eliminates any human error and cross-contamination from the samples because it is a closed system. The disadvantages of using the CBNAAT is that it could lead to false positive results due to the presence of amplification inhibition in the samples, and there are chances that it might have nucleic acid contamination which might lead to false results if the assay is not done carefully. The most important thing is the DNA in the dead bacilli could be amplified using the CBNAAT, therefore it should not be advised for patients who are in treatment. Stringent methods for quality control and quality assurance is required for performing this assay in the laboratory, and it cannot be used independently for the diagnosis, and it can be confirmed with phenotypic DST in discordant results. The machine and the cartridge for GeneXpert is temperature sensitive and it requires specialized facility. Care should be taken to make sure that blood and blood tinge samples are not sent to the laboratory for diagnosis using CBNAAT. So, next available technology is the line probe assay. The line probe assay is also a molecular test which is based on a reverse hybridization DNA strip technology. There are 2 kits of LPA which has been approved by FDA. One is the Genotype MTBDRplus version 2, which is a Haynes Life Science kit, which is generally called as a Haynes test. The other one is the Nipro NTM MDR TB detection kit 2. While the former detects MTB and resistant to drug resistance, the later kit detects MTB and drug resistance along with a few of the non-tuberculous mycobacterial species identification. The probes that are usually used in these kits are for the detection of mutations in the RPOB region for rifampicin resistance and for mutations in the INHA promoter region and CATG for isoniazid resistance. So, the line probe assay was recommended by WHO for use as a rapid diagnostic test for the detection of rifampicin as well as isoniazid resistance. In India, under the programmatic settings, the Haynes test is more commonly used, and it detects directly from the clinical specimen when you call it as a direct testing, and also from the bacterial isolates in case if the smear is negative. This cartoon gives the overview of the genotype MTBDRplus test procedure. So, there are four major steps involved here. One is the DNA extraction from the bacilli obtained from the smear positive specimens, followed by the release of the DNA from these smear specimens. The second step is the amplification by PCR using specific probes, and the third step involves the reverse hybridization procedure, where the amplified nucleic acid is bound to a DNA probes on the strips. The third step is a hybridization procedure, which involves the reverse hybridization of amplified nucleic acid to specific DNA probes that are bound on the strips. And following by that is the evaluation, which is based on an enzyme conjugate reaction and development of bands on the strips. So, this slide gives an overview of the result that is generated after doing a line probe assay. As you can see, each strip has about 27 loci located on it, which is basically it has a control for the conjugates, amplification controls, and also a band for the tuberculosis diagnosis. Apart from that, it has loci for RPOB, CATG and INHA, and in addition it has wild type loci and the mutant loci for all the three genes, the RPOB, CATG and INHA respectively. Based on the presence or absence of genes in each of these loci, the pattern of resistance and the identification of MTB is decided. So, if you can look at the right side of the result sheet, you can see on the first lane, you can see that it is positive, it has a band positive for tuberculosis and it is negative for wild type RPOB, and it is positive on mutation for CATG resistance. And so, this strain is resistant to rifampicin and isoniazid, and it is an MTB. So, the third lane shows that it is negative for the tuberculosis band and therefore, it is a MTB negative strain. So, this LPA is usually a useful methodology to rule in tuberculosis and multidrug resistant tuberculosis. So, this can also be used to detect monoresistance to isoniazid as well as rifampicin. And the turnaround time for LPA results is about 72 hours if the detection is made directly in the sputum. But in the case of smear negative cases, it may take more than 48 hours to 1 week. If you look at the specificity and sensitivity of MTBDRplus assays, rifampicin resistance both on MTB isolates and or the clinical specimens, it has a pooled sensitivity of 98% and a pooled specificity of 98.7%. For isoniazid resistance reduction, it has variable sensitivity and it is heterogeneous across different studies. So, if you look at the pooled sensitivity, is about 84.3% sensitive for isoniazid resistance reduction and a pooled specificity of 99.5%. What are the limitations of the line probe assay? The line probe assay requires a suitable laboratory facility with adequate skilled laboratory personnel, and the test is not useful in direct testing with smear negative sputum, the possibacillary TB cases, in the extrapulmonary TB as well as in samples with blood. So, culture based diagnosis for isoniazid resistance may still be used for evaluating patients when the LPA results are not detecting isoniazid resistance in a high pretest possibility of resistance to isoniazid. So, coming to the second line probe assay, which is called the MTBDRsL, this has been recently approved by FDA. And it identifies genetic mutations in the fluoroquinolone, the injectable second line TB drugs, namely the aminoglycosides and the cyclic peptides, and also for ethambutol in MDR and XDR patients. This is again one of the reliable methods to rule in second line drug resistance. WHO issued recommendations to use the second line LPA in May 2016. This is the first and only WHO recommended rapid test for the detection of additional resistance to MDR-TB patients as well as XDR-TB.